Hello, my name is Bastian Kuhn, and today I'm going to show you a short introduction into the CheckMK REST API. First, I'm going to show you the Swagger documentation, which you can use to play around a bit and to see all the calls which are possible. And then I'm going to show you where you can find some coding examples, how to use the API endpoints. At first, let's look into the Swagger documentation. You can find them on the left side, on the help part, and there is a link for REST API Interactive GUI. I'm going to open it in a new window. It just takes a moment to load. Okay, after the page is loaded, you just need to scroll a bit down. And in fact, it's quite a bit because here you already can find a lot of documentation. It's basically the syntax and the commands you can use for the replacement of the live status queries directly with the API. But of course, there is way more you can do. At some point, you're going to end up with the list of endpoints. And here we are. They are separated in different groups. You can go, for example, with the agents part, where you can handle everything related to the agent bakery, including getting agents, bake the agents, sign the agents. You can control the dynamic configuration daemon. You can set acknowledgements, which we look into later. You can activate changes. You can manage tags. You can set even rules for the business intelligence. You can handle your groups like contact groups, host groups, service groups. You can set downtimes. We're also going to look into that. You can get all the information from the event console. You can manage your folder structure in the setups, means creating folders, get a list of the folders, delete folders. You can do the same for hosts. Also for that, we're going to do a little example. So you can basically create hosts, delete hosts, or change even the attributes. And another group you can create, tag group you can create, then you can manage your password store. You can create every type of rule. You can search for rule sets. Here, the service status part is a replacement for everything you did with live status before. You can manage the service discovery, which means you can start discovery in other groups, and this time the service groups you can create, time periods. And finally, users, the last one, is just the version. The good thing here with the Swagger is you are already authenticated. So when I click on one of the endpoints, for example, the versions here, I can just try it out. This one has no parameters. I click execute. I see the request was sent. I see the URL to which the request is sent. And finally, I can see the response. The response, always like here, is a JSON object. So then let's do some examples. First, let's start with an acknowledgement. For that, I need the correct endpoint. That's basically on the beginning. Here you can set acknowledgement for host or for service. Let's start with a service. I'm going to try out. This time I have a request body where I need to fill out the needed information. First, acknowledge type, service, that's correct. We don't want to have the acknowledgement sticky. Sticky means when the acknowledgement is for a warning server. or for warning service, it will stays acknowledged if the state changes to critical. We don't want the command for persistent. This means the command stays at the service or server even the problem is gone. We don't want to send a notification. But what we need is comment. For this example, we just keep it how it is here. And now we just need to fill in the host and the service description. For that, I go back to CheckMK and look for a problem. I have two of them. Let's see. On P4E, I have the service CheckMK on failure. Let's use that. I enter then P4E. And here check underscore MK. I execute. I again see the curl request, which I can use on the command line to test it out. Just a little information here. If you do the same on the command line, you won't be authenticated. You need some header information for that. But I show you later how this works. For now, we stay with the response. Basically, there is none. But let's see. In CheckMK, there is already my acknowledgement. But now let's say we want to do a downtime. I scroll a bit down to the downtime part. Then I'm going to do a host related one. I'm going to try it out. Then again, I see the request body. I need to enter some valid information. Let's go back to March. Let's start at 10th and go until next month. The option here are start and end time. If you set the duration, which we don't do now, you're gonna create a flexible downtime. This time, let's stay with security updates. It's for host, and in this time, it's for the PV. We execute, and then we should already have a downtime here. I refresh, and with this icon here, I can see the host is in downtime. And as a final example, I'm going to show how to get the hosts and change the hosts. I'm now going to search for the host parts, which is here. And the most simple thing is to just get the list of all hosts. This endpoint. I just try out. I execute. And now the response is a little bit bigger, just not too big. I only have two objects. And there's a part value on the bottom. There we have the PVE host. And there we have, wait for more, a bit, a cluster object. And a bit down we have the test SRV. So that are basically our hosts we can work with. If I directly go to a host, let's use this as an example. Let's collapse this and go with show a host. We can try it out. Enter the host name here. The effective attributes just basically mean if you want to get all attributes which the host gets by folders. In my example, they are in the main directory and there's therefore nothing. So I can save that, just execute it. And now I just have this single object. One little part here is now important. In the response headers, you're also going to find this e-tag. If we later want to change this object, we need to make sure to have the latest e-tag. So basically, we prevent with this feature that we change within the API a host which was changed in between from another system. So imagine you load the host information, you want to change the host information and then store it back. But in between, this information is changed. So the e-tag will change and you wouldn't be able to update the system then. So we just copy it for now. And then finally, we're gonna add a label to the system. For that, we need the update host. It's like here, it's the put one. We're gonna try out. We need to enter the e-tag header here. We need to enter the host name. And here you already see a little example how to add new attributes, this part here, how to update existing attributes, so basically how to change them, and how to remove them. We want to add new ones, so basically I'm gonna remove this both from the examples. And since we have JSON here, you need to remove the comma here as well. It's not like in Python. And we wanted to create the label. So best for that would be that we can see how labels look. So let's go back to the response here. And sadly, we scroll down in the attributes, we just have a tag, but not yet a label. So to show you how to find out how they look, I'm gonna just add a label to one of the hosts. Let's use this one. Let's go with server, yes. I activate the changes. Then I query this host. And now we can see in attributes, we have a key labels. And there we have our server label. I copy it. Paste it in here. I remove the IP address part because I don't need it. I just want to set the label. And test label, yes, execute. Sorry, I need to remove the comma here, execute. And we see a 200 response. If we look then on the system, we see the label. Another nice way to see these labels is actually also possible in the overview. If I go back to the folder with the display option, I can say show explicit host labels. And now I can already see it here. If you now want to build your own scripts, I'm gonna show you another documentation. It's also with help. And it's the REST API documentation. Also, this documentation needs a moment to load. On the left side, then you find some examples. As I showed before, acknowledgement and downtimes. Let's use acknowledgement as example. Here you now have the full documentation about the params. And the best thing here, on the right side, you got the examples. This is the normal payload, but you can see a Python example for the whole thing. Another Python example with OrLib. On the right side, you can see the payload. You can see a request example with Python. You can see OrLib example with Python. And for example, if you want to work on the command line, there's even a curl example with a bash script. The final thing we need to talk about is the authentication. It's really simple. It's either a user with a password or automation secret. As you can see in the example here, for the authentication, just this header is needed and the username and the password is set here. These users here are nothing else than the ones you can find in setup users. And you can either use the automation with the automation secret or a normal user with a normal password here. I hope this video gave you a short introduction into the CheckMKI REST API. Don't forget to subscribe and see you next time.